conditional deal, try to land it on behalf of Wirral, was actually agreed some 12 months ago, and they've had that amount of time to get all of these orders in place. And I think it's, frankly, I think it's just appalling that we are still, as late as this afternoon, getting the latest drafts. reference has been made to the letter that has been sent through, again, as late as today, by Andrew Percy, the Minister for Local Growth and the Northern Powerhouse, who is sort of leading the government's work on the devolution now. And again, I need to express my concern to Council about the fact that we've still got a number of really important powers and funding streams that we negotiated in the deal last year that have still not been signed off by government. And the letter from Andrew Percy gives an update, if you like, on where we are with those two areas. And what the first one is the devolution of the adult education budget, and the second one is the co-production of the work and health programme with the work and pensions. Now, you know, I have to say I'm not 100% satisfied with the assurances in this letter. Talks about commitment to targeting Easter 2017 for laying orders before Parliament for the adult education powers, and then the work and health programme talks about pilot programme and the memorandum of understanding. I do think, again, it's very regrettable that the government haven't signed off the agreement in full. But I refer to the final paragraph of this letter, where the Minister does say that the government is committed to delivering the agreed devolution agreement in full, and we have to take those words as they're written down, but we will be holding them to account with that commitment. Can I say that, yes, you know, I think we've had a number of debates about the devolution deal. I think it does give us great opportunities, but we will not be accepting either the Tory or the Liberal Democrat amendment tonight. The Tory amendment talks about congratulating the government on the trust that they should show the authorities. When, frankly, you know, as we've seen demonstrated, they've treated us appallingly. So, you know, and okay, £900 million is important in terms of the gain share, but that pales into that insignificance of that the huge amount of money that we've had from our should be ashamed, so we won't be agreeing with paragraph A. On the scrutiny arrangements between both the Liberal Democrats and the Tory amendment, the formula that we've got before us tonight is the formula that the DCLG, the government, we suggested, i.e. 10 out of 20 overview scrutiny members before calling can be agreed. I think that's a reasonable requirement, and can I just remind the Council that the chair of the overview scrutiny committee will be an opposition member. So I think that is a reasonable requirement. And then finally, on the other element of the Lib Dem motion about the new paragraph F, requiring us or asking us to work in a cohesive way, consult and involve members, I agree with the sentiments, but that doesn't need to form part of these orders, which is a really the kind of precursor to the new constitution for combined authority. So I'm happy to take those sentiments back to my colleagues on combined authority, but I think we need to agree that that wording for purposes tonight. So in closing, Mr. Mayor, I will argue, I will propose the paragraphs that we agree, paragraphs A to E, in the agenda item 3. We should reject the two amendments, and if this is agreed tonight, it will go forward together with the other boroughs that are meeting this week for a special meeting with the Combined Authority on Friday to endorse this whole package. But we will, in closing, we'll be holding the government's feet to the fire on those outstanding powers that they've still not honoured. Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. I so move.
Okay, so anyone wants to speak regarding a point of clarification?
Yes, Chair, just
the centre from Westminster and Whitehall and out to more locally focused services and decision making. It is somewhat of a shame that the Labour administration themselves, whilst they ought to support devolution, I notice in the cabinet papers that are coming forward, have decided to cut the money to constituency committees and also pause whilst a review. So it seems to me the Labour Party are prepared to support the principle of devolution when it comes from the centre down to the city region, but not when it's from the council itself to local communities. And that's a broad inconsistency. But we have, Mr. Mayor, been consistent. We have talked about the need for locally based decisions. We have suggested that decisions taken and the co-creation of services on a local basis should lead to better decision making. And the government has pledged to shift £900 million away from the centre and to the city region. But I think as people reference, in fact, there's a court case going on at the moment about executive power and how people should be included and involved. There is an issue about that. And we've said this consistently in all the consultation when people have come and spoken to us, and we've sought them out to speak to them, that the arrangements in place with these resources need to be inclusive. I don't believe that the arrangements put in place for the scrutiny, because we were assured that scrutiny would manage this, I do not believe they are sufficiently inclusive or taking account of the authorities that make up the city region, giving them sufficient voice. It strikes me that these places will broadly be filled with committees will be filled by administration, by the administrations, and will not take account of other groups within those local authorities. And it seems to me that we should, as a minimum, and as it says in this amendment, with great resources and executive authority, should come the ability for accountability and scrutiny. I don't think these proposals, as laid out in the orders, actually achieve that. This is something we've talked about, something we've said. I think the Leader of the Council had promised in the past to take those back for them to be discussed, but either he doesn't really agree that they should be more inclusive, or he can't persuade his colleagues they should be more inclusive. And it strikes me the Labour Party have been more interested in getting Steve Rotherham elected, Jeremy Corbyn's PPS, than actually thinking about what needs to be done with regards to scrutiny. So I would absolutely recommend, and this amendment does, that the Leader of the Council goes back and says to his colleagues on the combined authority that the scrutiny arrangements need to be more inclusive, more representative of the region as a whole, has more representation of the local authorities that make up the region. I will, Mr. Mayor, and just wind me up right now, and to make sure, Mr. Mayor, that we actually do have a scrutiny arrangement that our residents who are seeing the actions of this city region can have some confidence that those decisions are being taken. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. It's been what might call a long and winding road, if you forgive the song from the 60s or 70s, but we have made it to this particular point. There are some authorities that didn't make it to this point, some that fell apart, like in the North East, for example. So at least we have a degree of Merseyside unity. Where we're going to fall apart is over the issue of scrutiny. Mr. Mayor, it's years, the Leader mentioned, since we first passed five of all the councils meeting on one night, and it seems to me that where the heavy lifting was done then, the detailed work was done, but we've been faced at short notice in the last few weeks some more detailed work on the legalities. I trust, rather hope, there are no mistakes in those legalities. section 22 on scrutiny and paragraph 4.1, if those who want to find it eventually, five members of the overview and scrutiny committee there can call matters in. That's rather different from the scheme we're in of. When I look at Greater Manchester, well, I'm sorry, I don't expect you to read all 276 pages of their constitution, but I can tell you that on page 268 there is a schedule. And that schedule says there is a scrutiny pool, three councillors from each council. The scrutiny calling decisions can be requested by any five members from the scrutiny pool. So 10 authorities, five members can call something in. In our case, six authorities, you have to get the magic figure of 10. Doesn't seem to match up to me, and that is from the constitution published in November 2015 and not changed since. And this scrutiny process doesn't add up. There is an issue touched on in the arrangements about reporting back to council. We're used to trying to get report back at this council. Questions confined to the cabinet members' reports. Mr. Mayor, I looked at Peterborough in Cambridgeshire. Particular clause in there's a protocol requiring the council leader and the representative on the overview and scrutiny committee to report at each meeting of council, setting out the activities and decisions relating to their respective roles. Now, I rather hope that we don't get one side of a piece of paper with a few bullet points on. We have the chance tonight to change and improve the scrutiny. I believe that could be done. We haven't set ourselves a straitjacket. Mr. Mayor, I'm not quite at the stage where you will appear on the Chester High Road, somewhere between Gate and Parkgate, with a new sign which will say you are now entering the Liverpool City region. I'm sure that will go down well in Heswell, but if you ever get round to unveiling one, we look forward to the occasion. Not everything is sweetness and light. For those members who read first last week, Leader of Rochdale had an article that said city regions need donut mayors. He was highly critical of the centralisation in Manchester. We need to be careful of centralisation here, Mr. Mayor. I bring my remarks to a close. Effective scrutiny will enable us to ensure that it is not just about one part of our six councils other than another. We want to play a part, we want to play a fair and equal part. We would like to know what's going on rather than be kept in the dark.
Okay, I'd like to now open up to the floor.
Call seconders, Mr. Mayor.
Call seconders, Mr. Mayor. Okay. Yeah.
standing orders for a motion to be moved in the course of a debate. Calling for seconds. I've also approved standing order 12, subparagraph 14, which deals with closure motions, and again, can see no reference to the calling of seconders for calling a during the course of a debate. The question was put to me from the secretary position with Councillor Carubia. What are we voting on, Mr. Mayor? There is no provision whatsoever in standing orders for seconders to be called. There are a range of other provisions, but no provision for the calling of seconders. Mr. Mayor, this vote was contrary, I would submit, to standing orders. And I would also ask, the Leader of the Council has gone out of his way to call a special council meeting to hear a debate, and then moves to curtail debate by using a device that is not allowed in the council standing orders. And I'd quite like an explanation for that as well.
Certainly does not give a true reflection of what other authorities believe is the right way to move forward.
seem to be done to make sure that it's clear and held to account. And the only way we can do that is make sure that the people who have been given the opportunity to vote whether you want to elect a mayor or not actually see that it's working correctly and openly so that everybody has the relevant information. That's why we moved the amendments that we did to the original notice of motion, which we've updated. And I'm still waiting for confirmation on the comments I made at the beginning of this meeting, in that we received papers today, which we're debating now, and any other normal circumstances, we would have 5 clear days notification, 5 clear work days notification of what was before us before we had voted. Thank you, Mr. Davis.
We will, I give this commitment, we will
absolutely use council meetings, my legal report to report back to this council on the devolution deal. The meetings of the combined authority will be in public, and as I repeat earlier on, the chair of the open scrutiny committee will be a member of the opposition. I think all of those mechanisms in place mean there should be accountability. So with that, Mr. Mayor, I'm happy to